First, I guess I just want to say thank you to Joan and to Jen for inviting me here. Every time I come to GCC, I'm always just really impressed with the work here. It's really a great testament, not only to the faculty, but just the community of people here in Greenfield. So I'm happy to be here. For those of you who don't know me, I work mostly as a painter. I do sometimes make some art installations, but usually just 2D on the wall. I teach in an architecture department, which is a little unusual for a painter. I taught in studio art at UMass and at Amherst College and at Mount Holyoke College for about 6 years before I moved over into the architecture department. And in 2014, when I did go over to architecture, it kind of opened this whole new world to me. It was sort of like moving to a different country and learning a different language. And it was both bewildering, but also really inspiring and exciting. And it made me kind of rethink what painting, in particular, has to offer to sort of interdisciplinary studies of architecture, landscape architecture, and environmental design. So what is it that we as image makers can offer these other disciplines? So I'm going to talk just a little bit. I'm going to start talking just a little bit about that. And, you know, just to give a really short history, many of you know that art and architecture really kind of grew up together in the Renaissance, and they both really shared the same issues with perspective and geometry and spatial construction and design. And landscape architecture also, which didn't really evolve until, you know, the 1800s, also has a really, really strong connection to painting. So when landscape architecture first evolved, it really came out of kind of the horticulture gardening movement. And at the time, this was sort of like when romanticism and painting was really important. And so the landscape architects were really trying to create this sense of place through the manipulation of different land forms. And they would look at these idyllic kind of landscapes, and that would influence the way that they wanted to see landscape being developed. So then, you know, in the 19th and 20th century, landscape architecture started to kind of get away from art, and it became much more connected to like urban planning and civil engineering and things like that. And at the same time, in the last, say, 50 years or so, landscape architecture has also been really at the forefront of the environmental movement. And so some of the landscape architects have begun to theorize about what is the relationship between landscape and site and place. And so my first year in the architecture department, I read some essays from this book called The Landscape Imagination. That's how I titled my talk. And it's written by a guy named James Corner, who some of you might know he's a pretty well-known landscape architect. He did the High Line. He was behind the High Line in New York City. He also started as a writer and a philosopher, so his writing is really kind of dense and rich. And he, in one of his really important essays that was kind of like an aha moment for me, he wrote about this thing called the eidetic operations in new landscapes. And eidetic operations, I had to look this word up because I had never heard of it, but eidetic meant to be working with images, to be thinking with images. And in this essay, he really calls for designers and planners to enhance their creative capacities by this method of really thinking through images, not through words or not through plans, but through images themselves. So he says, and I'm going to read just a couple of his quotes because he's so articulate. They're a little chewy, but no one can say it just the way that he does. So in this one, he says, specific ideational techniques for construing, imagining, and constructing or projecting new landscapes. And this was kind of his definition of what eidetic operations means. And here's a picture of the High Line. I know many of you have been there. He also makes collages himself. And this is one of his collages. And he argues, he says that designers need to more fully equip their arsenal of eidetic operations in both the imaginative and efficacious senses of technogeographies. And technogeographies was another word I had to look up, which really has to do with kind of the merging of skills, tools, knowledge, and technology all together. So he writes that how one generates and effectuates ideas is bound into a cunning fluency with imaging. Similarly, the future of landscape as a culturally significant practice is dependent on the capacities of its inventors to image the world in new ways and to body forth those images in richly phenomenal and efficacious terms. So for me, this was kind of a really important realization, is like this knowledge that I have of creating, imagining new landscapes is applicable not just in the world of art and painting, but also in future design and planning and kind of the way that we create and want to create space in the future. So one of the things he does is he, and I want to just make this distinction here, is the difference between imaging and picturing. So imaging or picturing is really like kind of a mechanical representation of the visible, and it could include a Google map, it could be a photograph, it could be a land survey, it could be a real estate plot. And imaging is really includes those things which are not visible. So for him, imaging is really trying to bring forth the things that are not visible in an external sense. So those are kind of maybe the more experiential things, the more phenomenological things. And he uses these, he calls them eidetic mappings, to try to express those things that are not necessarily visible. That these are the things that lie at the core of shaping an invisible landscape, one that is more an unfolding spatiality than a surface appearance, more a poetic property than a delineation of immediate real estate. So imaging, he says, always exercises agency, okay? It's about freedom. It's actively unfolding, it's actively generating, it's not a linear, it's not a logical thing, it's something that is maybe illogical or has layers, lots of layers of logic. The other distinction that I want to make here is the distinction between landscape and site. So landscape is something that is abstract. It's usually some sort of an idealized projection. It's also very historically tied to painting. It's associated with scenery, it's subjective, and it's imaginary. It's both conceptual and formal. Sight is actual, sight is physical. It has political, ecological, social, and economic implications. It is not imaginary. It is actual and real, as in real estate. So both are shifting and unstable, but landscape is disclosed by artistic means. It can be made wider and weirder, more abstract and uncanny. I like to think of painting as the unfolding surface appearance. And by this, I mean that it has the unique ability to convey a complex and deeply penetrable surface, which unfolds to reveal itself through its materiality. This is what I like to call the glowing mud. Painting consists of layers, like stratified sediments. It is deposited on the surface, and it can be thick and opaque, or thin and transparent. It can be sensual, like the buttery icing on a cake, or it could be fluid and watery, like a spill on the floor. Painting is a haptic medium. Architects love this word, haptic. Haptic means the sense of touch. Painting is a haptic medium. It conveys touch, the touch of the brush, the touch of a finger. Its appearance leaves traces of scratches, brush strokes, or fingerprints, or trowels. It's also performative. It conveys gesture, time, process, and energy. So if painting conveys an unfolding surface appearance, then landscape painting unfolds a surface appearance of place, conveys an unfolding surface appearance of place, including temperature with its light-bearing load, and mood with its misunderstood messiness. It can express both depth and width, perspective, and its many devices for understanding space. These are some of my favorite artists that I'm showing. It can morph panoramic narratives into tight compositions, and in many ways, it shares the same elements of composition used in landscape design, like making pathways, groupings, and clusters. Like landscape architecture, it establishes rhythm, pattern, and enclosures, defining figure ground, and the organization of space. So I also recently discovered this landscape architect, Brazilian landscape architect, who is also a painter, and his name is Roberto Burle Marx, and he really was, he's a very modernist, kind of, I think he started to become well known in like the 50s and 60s, and his paintings and his landscape designs are so clearly interconnected with each other that I want to show a few of them. This is a painting. This is a landscape design. His aerial designs were often direct translations of his modernist abstract paintings. But these are not eidetic operations in the same way that James Corner is talking about it. Eidetic operations are much more about kind of the complex, it's not a direct translation, it's a complex kind of non-linear translation of space. So it's more kind of experiential, more phenomenological, more sensual. And I like to think about how, you know, a painting like this that may convey a sense of mood or memory could then be translated into a landscape like this using light and glass and stone. Or how a painting like this, which is really kind of blurring the earth and the sky together, could be translated into a piece of architecture that does the same thing. So this is what I think James Corner was talking about with the landscape imagination, that it was this kind of power to that transcends visualization. And I like to think that landscape painting has the possibility to really enrich and illuminate this power. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about my own personal process of how I make paintings. It really involves this kind of very complicated collecting and cutting apart and isolating different elements and then putting them back together. So it's almost like, in some ways, I think about it as like a Lego set, you know, except that I don't have directions and I'm making my own pieces. So I try to like get lots of different little pieces together and then I put them together in some sort of a collage. And then when I'm working them in this collage, it's a very much a kind of like push-pull type of thing, and I make lots of work that doesn't work out, that is unsuccessful. But through that kind of wrestling with the image over and over again, I do try to come up with some sort of a composition that makes sense as a whole. And once that happens, then I will translate that compositional sketch into a painting. I've always seen this really strong visual relationship between forests and cities. They're both these kind of glittering spectacles of light and structural complexity. They both grow upwards and outwards on vertical and horizontal frameworks, and they're both living systems. I think a lot about the evolutionary cycle of cities, the way that new cities are kind of built over and out of their own collapsed past. And in this way, the forest is also a great metaphor, because you have like the dead tree that dies and it fertilizes the undergrowth, and then new things can grow up from that. I see this cycle of creative destruction in my process a lot, in my practice. Some of the work has to be kind of destroyed over and over again before it settles into something that works. And these kind of layers that happen in a painting and in a collage remind me of the stratigraphy of the built environment as well. In 2014, I visited Rome. And if you've been there or any place like that, you can see these accumulative layers of civilization are just acutely visible and really just super inspiring. Everywhere you go, there's this kind of ongoing process of things being built up and things being destroyed at the same time. There's this ruination and this restoration that is happening constantly, always. This simultaneous kind of digging down into the earth and then also building it up. And I feel very, I feel like painting is very connected to that kind of process. So this was a painting I made of an excavation site when I got back from Rome. And really just thinking about that rich accumulation of layers and how it resembles paintings. When I do make an image, I'm thinking a lot about shape relationships, composition, color, and how these things inform one's experience of place, how the flows of traffic, transportation, and infrastructure are formed over and around the existing environment. In the last, I'd say, 4 or 5 years, I've been looking a lot at these pictorial maps. There's actually a really great map collection that is online. It's part of the Boston Public Library. It's called the Norman B. Leventhal Map Collection. And they have this really broad array of these pictorial maps of New England, and a lot of this one is Holyoke here, and actually this painting, which is in this show behind you, was derived from this pictorial map. And these maps are really funny. You know, a lot of them were made kind of before the city. It was right when the city was, Holyoke is a planned city. It was one of the few planned cities. And it was almost like they were making these maps as a kind of propaganda to get people to come to these cities. And they were like, look, we've got all these industry and these, you know, burning towers that are polluting the air, but we've got jobs and we've got houses and we're making this place for you to come stay. It was almost like this utopian vision that they wanted to attract people to come there. And of course now, you know, that seems so ironic in a way, knowing Holyoke as this kind of Rust Belt city and what it has gone, the hopes of what it was once trying to be and then what it has become. But Holyoke is, I just love Holyoke. I think it's a super inspiring city in many of the same ways that Rome is, that there's these kind of layers of history that are kind of part of the nostalgia of the entire place. So one of the things I love about these bird's eye view perspectives is this kind of widening sense of elevation. It's like not quite a map, but you do get this kind of big perspective of a particular place. And they're also kind of abstract. And there is this kind of purposeful distortion that the map makers do that I really like as well. This is another one, Lonsdale. And this was a painting that I made from that particular map. I'm going to talk just a little about a project that I'm working on now. It's in 2016, I was commissioned by New York City's Construction Authority to make a mural for the Public Art for Public Schools program. And this was something I really fought hard for. I was actually a finalist twice before I got the commission. So I, for about a year, I was preparing proposals, one that I didn't get, and then another one that I didn't get, and then finally I got this one. I think it's probably the most extensive, biggest project that I've ever done. It's teaching me a lot, and it is kind of overwhelming me a little bit with the amount of work that is going on in it. It's a $50,000 proposal, which sounds like a lot of money, but it's really not at all. So I wanted to do the entire thing out of mosaic and tile, but I couldn't because the mosaic that I wanted to use was $500 a square foot. So I had to come up with a design where I could use part of the mosaic tile, especially the parts that are in the lower part where the children would be touched, that would need to be, you know, really hardy and dirty, sturdy, and then the upper parts of the ceiling that were up high could be made of something that I would fabricate myself. So I began to experiment with this material, this paint on aluminum dye bond. I started out by really thinking about, like, if I was going to take my paintings apart, like looking around and just imagine, like, again, kind of like the Lego pieces, like taking those Lego pieces out of the painting and isolating them into separate pieces, then how would it allow me to kind of move images around? So I started cutting these little pieces out of the dye bond, the aluminum dye bond, and then painting the surface of it. And this is my studio now. We're in the process of fabricating that upper part. I also went to Munich, Germany, and I'm collaborating with a fabricator there who does mosaic tile. And this is some pictures of their studios there. The one on the left, you can see they have a mirror on the ceiling so they can see what they're working on, because everything has to be, you know, worked on a level surface. Mosaic artisans have studied, like Julia, who's in the picture right there. She studied for 3 years in Italy how to do this craft, and it's incredibly difficult. I tried my own hand, and when I looked at the piece that I made next to the piece that she made, it was like, oh boy. So this was the her mosaic test samples. It's all made of glass tesserae, and then on the bottom it's a combination of glass tesserae with porcelain ceramic tiles with paint on it. And then the piece on the right is going to be the top part of the mural, and that's the part that I'm fabricating right now. So the kind of tricky part of this was how to make those two areas go together. How can we blend the mosaic part with my part? So we've did this one-to-one printout of the design, and we're sending it back and forth. So I make these little pieces, like my little Lego pieces, and then I send it to them, and then they make a little piece and they send it back to me. And so this has been a really huge learning curve for me to be working on this project, and I feel really lucky to be doing it, but I also feel sort of overwhelmed at the moment, and I haven't had a chance to do any other sort of painting for the last year. It's going to be finished this summer and installed in a school in the Bronx in August. So yeah, that's it. Any questions? Yeah.
So can you say again what the material is that you're making a part of this?
Yeah. So this is the 7-foot line right here, and everything above it, so all of these pieces up here are made of acrylic paint on a material called aluminum dye bond. And dye bond it's two sheets of aluminum with a little PVC in between them, and it's a signage material. But it's really, what's wonderful because it's light and it's stiff, and you can cut it like with a jigsaw any kind of shape that you want. That's the name of the material, yeah.
How do you deal with the difference in texture with the tiles on the lower portion and the aluminum plates on with wash on top?
Yeah, it's tricky. I mean, it's kind of an improvisation because I like, you see in a lot of my paintings, I like a really matte finish. But sometimes I do use a really glossy finish as well as kind of like a separate piece. So I'm trying to work it out with the mosaic that there's kind of that collaged look where some of it is glossy and some of it is matte. And some of these parts that I'm painting, like right in here, it's kind of hard to see, but I've been painting a mosaic. So I'm kind of mimicking the way that a mosaic would be painted. that's the tricky part of this whole piece, is like trying to get, I want there to be a kind of a unity while still having, you know, that difference of materials.
Rectangular pieces are a rectangular piece of dye bond that you've then painted on?
Yeah, nothing is completely rectangular, but yeah, there's shaped pieces. So I made each panel no bigger than 34 by 66 inches, because that's the maximum width of the back of my car. And I didn't want to rent a truck, and I also wanted to be able to handle each piece really easily, so that when I go put it on the wall, it's like, you know, I can do it by myself. And
so the dye bond stuff that you're putting up there, like there's a blue six-sided figure up there surrounded
uh-huh.
by a couple.
Yeah.
Right. So that's not a single piece.
Well, the piece is, it's kind of a, exactly. It's cut like that.
Right.
There's nine in this hole. There's nine panels right there, and then these separate pieces.
So you're not going to cut those little pieces apart?
They are cut apart.
They're already.
They're cut
the
before
pieces.
I,
okay.
Yeah.
And then painted.
Yeah, they're cut and then sanded and then painted, and it's like a puzzle piece. The whole thing will go back together like a puzzle piece.
How do you put them on the wall?
They're going to be adhered to the wall with this stuff called iron nails, which is kind of like a silicone base. Oh, well, first they're going to install all of the mosaic and the tile on the bottom, and then I'll have a scissor lift and some assistance, and we'll start at the bottom and we'll put each piece on the wall like that. It'll go up.
I mean, in your studio while you're working on the pieces, how do you...
So in my studio, I use this temporary tacky putty and these little L-shaped nails to hold them in so that I can easily just take them on and off the wall. So I paint them on a big table, and then sometimes I paint it on the wall, but most of the painting's done on a big table. Yeah.
So you'll never see this together until it's installed, right?
That's right.
Yeah, and it's 28 feet tall,
yeah.
By 19.
Uh-huh. 18, yeah. It's a big, yep, I have no idea what it's going to look like.
Is it inside the school or is it outside?
It's in the lobby. It's a new school addition, and it's a beautiful school addition, and the architect was one of the jurors that when I was commissioned, and their kind of idea, one of the concepts for their school is that it would have, it's four stories high. And each story had a color code, so it was winter, and then spring, and then summer, and then fall. And so I incorporated that into my design. So this part of the design is winter, and then it's spring, and then it's summer, and then it's fall. And there's a window. So this is a window that goes to the outside, and then this is a window that can look down on the mural from the second level. So the people will be able to see it from different levels.
Will the public be able to see this if it's in the school?
That's the unfortunate thing about it, is it's difficult for the public to see. They would have to call and make an appointment and then show their ID, and because, you know, the public schools have security. And so I'll just have to get really good pictures. But it's also, I feel really good about where it's going, and that these, you know, it's going to be part of these kids' experience growing up in this place. And the idea for the piece itself is, it goes kind of with my whole sort of forest city or architecture garden combo. And I was thinking of it as like a kind of a urban garden oasis. And the area in the Bronx is kind of a difficult area. There's big highways. There's a lot of traffic. It's not a peaceful neighborhood at all. And the lobby, I kind of felt like it would be really important to be able to come in there and just like have this kind of space that is kind of a safe haven from that busyness. Yeah.
Yes, I would like to know. You said someone asked a question earlier about, have you ever seen the entire project? But I would like to ask you, as an architect, Did you do entire mock-ups or cartoons of this prior to putting it into that scale? Did you do thumbnails or?
Oh yeah, no, I had to, this is the one of the designs here that you're seeing. That's a digital rendering. And it's one that has been revised maybe 6 times because I had to work with a whole committee to make sure that it was, you know, something that everybody would agree to and that I could afford with the budget that I was given. And so there's the one thing about design that has been a really important lesson for me is that there's always, you have to do it again and again and again and again. You never just do it once. So like as a painter, you know, you kind of just, you do the painting and then hopefully it comes out well and then you put it aside. In design, it's like you do it and then you do it again and then you have to do it again and then you have to do it again and again. And so, but each time you do see it kind of getting a little bit more refined and better. And so this process of making this and like working with the public and working with committees and architects and, you know, school principals and who wants this, you know, I mean, there's a lot of, it's not like I'm just working for myself in my studio and painting what I want to paint anymore. It's a collaborative effort, and it has definitely exercised my understanding of that in a way that I've never had to do before. Yeah.
How did you find out about those other materials that you used, like the dye mock?
I had made some work in 2013 that these kind of, I called them pop-ups drawing, pop-up paintings. They were on paper and they were kind of folded and I needed a stiff backing to put them on, and wood was not working at all. So I went to a signage company to see like, what do you have? And then I took a bunch of samples and I started playing around with it that way. So I was sort of familiar with it. I didn't know what I was going to do with it, but I'm glad that I showed this. I threw this in at the end, this last public art thing, because it's not finished. So I wasn't sure if I should show it, but it sounds like everyone's interested in that one.
You have some work on your website, the installations, and you didn't show them because you have all paintings and then this. Do you have any of those on this laptop? Because some of those are really, remind me of this in its spatial thing, and yet they're very different because they're so site specific in a way.
So this was a mural that I did in 5 days in January in a rock gym in Louisville, Colorado, and I had 4 assistants and we got up on ladders and made it happen. This was the design, so it was a purely digital design. I was really inspired by Stuart Davis, some of Stuart Davis's paintings. And they also had a really kind of specific color palette that they wanted to work with, so they gave me this color palette. I've never had to do this before. Somebody gave me a color palette. They're like, okay, here's what we want to do. And then anything else I could do on my own, and there we are with our ladders. It was really a precarious place to work. Like, we were on this little board up there. No, 5 days. We did it in 5 days. And this board, I remember the first day that I got up there, I was like, oh my God, I feel sick. And then by the third or fourth day, it was fine. I was just fine with it. But yeah, we put it together, and that was a fun little project. But other than that, I haven't had the opportunity to do too many murals. They're a lot of work. I mean, it's really exhausting. When I finished this one, I wanted to be in bed for a week. it's not just physical, but it's like there's a lot of pressure. People are counting on you. Like, if you don't get it wrong, then I don't know. I just felt really stressed
where
the entire time.
In Colorado.
It was a rock gym, a brand new rock gym in Louisville, Colorado. See the climbing holds? So that's the whole gym. They were just opening, so it's a little rough there. But it was a fun space, and I climb, and I knew the woman who was starting this project, and so it was fun to kind of bring those interests of mine together, climbing and painting.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about difference between meeting an artist working in the studio alone and listening to yourself and having you as your primary audience and working as you are here, where you're collaborating. There are things that are obviously different.
Yeah.
I just wonder in terms of you as an art maker, what you give up and what you gain.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a good question that I think a lot of art makers, I mean, I personally like my solitude and privacy, and I would be really happy kind of holed up in my studio making little landscapes, but not for long. Like, I did do that. There was a year before I was teaching, or a couple of years, and I was just alone in the studio all the time, and it was too much. I felt too isolated. I didn't feel connected enough to people. And right now, it's like the opposite. I'm teaching 3 classes in tenure track position. I have committees, advisees, blah, blah, blah. I've got this public art thing, and I've had no time to just like be holed up in my studio and have that like private painting time, and I miss it. I do. You know, you try to find a balance, I guess. Like, I like to feel connected to a community, and teaching is great that way because you can still have that conversation with people, and in most cases, I think with teaching, it can be really balanced. Like, you can have 3 or 4 days of teaching and then 2 or 3 days of studio. But I just haven't been able to find that balance in the last year with this public art project. It's been, and the other thing with the public art thing is, like, it's very, like, the creative decisions are mostly done now. And so it's very much about executing, you know, and in some ways, I relate to the architects. Like, they do their design, and then it's just like you get the thing built, and it's all this kind of practical, you know, materiality and how to, you know, problem solving and all of that, which is, it's fun, but I do miss that kind of like just being able to conjure, you know, something completely new, but soon it's going to happen again.
As an artist, how do you feel when decisions are made collaboratively and you don't agree and it affects the integrity of your work?
Usually in public art, the people are try to be respect. They commission you and hire you because they like your vision. They want you to be yourself, and so they are respectful of what that is. But it's also, I think that it is a kind of a negotiation, you know, between things. You know, like somebody might say, well, that material just isn't gonna work. It's not sturdy enough. And then you have to rethink something that will work. Or someone might say, like, that this line is just, it's just not going with the architecture. And then I think as a designer, you kind of have to be open to what they're saying and still stay loyal to whatever your vision is. But it's a negotiation, you know, you're constantly, I don't think it's good to be too rigid, but I do think you need to maintain your own sense of what you want to say. It's sort of like writing, you know, like you want it to be edited really well, but you still want the story to be yours, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question about that you moved from the art department to the architecture department.
Yeah.
So I'm curious about what precipitated that and what action do you do and, you know, what role do you play in the
architecture department? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's a good question, too. So I teach primarily foundations, and the Department of Architecture and the Department of Art and Art History were all one department up until 2014. So it was the department, UMass Department of Art, Art History, and Architecture. And the architecture program really grew out of the art department back in the 70s and 80s. So I was already teaching the foundations program with the architecture students. And in 2014, all the departments got a divorce. And they each became their own autonomous department. And architecture hired me as a tenure track professor, and studio offered me a 3-year lecturing term. So I went with the, and I also, I knew the people in architecture. It's a really fantastic, I have great colleagues and they're super supportive, and it's just a wonderfully kind of progressive group, and I wanted to be with them. So that's, I also come from a family of architects. My grandfather and my father were both architects, so I sort of felt like it was a coming home. I'm going to go live with Dad. So, yeah. Well, thank you, everyone, for coming.